I love science fiction. I love it as a genre in prose, in movies, in video games, and it stands to reason I would love it in comics, and I do. In fact, I find comics particularly good at doing science fiction, probably because it has the text which gives us the intimacy and psychological realism and depth that prose does, but also the images that visualize science fiction concepts, whether they're in technology or otherwise. And I love science fiction in comics, whether it's as hard science fiction or just the slightest touch of it, so much so that when I conducted a poll on what the next top 10 video that we make should be, and top 10 science fiction won by quite a lot, I found myself stuck with a lot of favorites. I've finally been able to boil it down to a top 10, but the ones that came close but didn't make it are so worthy that honestly I felt quite bad not talking about them. Which is why in this episode of For the Love of Comics, we'll be counting down the honorable mentions for my top 10 science fiction comics of all time. What separates these from my final top 10 is very, very little. In fact, I have 11 books on the table in front of me right now, and one of them is going to go into the top 10. It's not actually going to feature in this video. I'm going to make that final decision as I'm shooting this. I'll go over these titles really quickly, and in spite of it being so close, I'll try to explain a little bit about why they didn't make it into the final 10. Be sure to check back in a couple of days for that video, which I'll link to up here when it's done. And with all that out of the way, let's jump into the honorable mentions for my favorite sci-fi comics of all time. Now, these are in no particular order, but the first one is probably the most significant. My first honorable mention, The Inkal by Yodorovsky and Moebius. The Inkal might be one of the most influential science fiction comics, or maybe even comics in general of all time. Created from the remnants of the failed Dune movie that Yodorovsky couldn't make, The Inkal has inspired generations of comic books creators, as well as filmmakers and short story writers and novelists. Its view of human and alien life in the distant future is a madcap romp in many ways, and I would agree with anyone who wants to label this one of the greatest science fiction comics of all time. The reason it doesn't quite make my top 10 is, in spite of its amazing world building and just spectacular art by Moebius, I find the story a little lacking. This is purely personal. I don't really like the central character that much, and the quest seems almost beside the point, but the sheer breadth of imagination on display over here means that this is not one of those comics that you necessarily need to read every word of to really enjoy. So that's my first honorable mention, The Inkal by Yodorovsky and Moebius. The next book in my honorable mentions may be more famous than The Inkal. It is Saga by Brian K. Vaughan and Fiona Staples. Saga is both a critical and commercial smash, and I love it. It has all of the out there and bizarre elements that we expect from space opera, but remains deeply rooted in characters and relationships and themes of family, some very universal and perhaps mainstream ideas wrapped up in some very bizarre packaging. As much as I love Saga, I don't know how much it's actually going to hold up, which means that I'm really invested in it right now. I'm dying to know what happens next, and I gallop through every single story, but I don't know if I'm going to return to it in 4 years, 5 years' time. I don't know if it's going to age very well. And because there are things like that in comics, in movies, and television shows that really appeal to you at a certain point of time, but you find that you've gotten most of everything out of it in that first thing, and it doesn't really reward rewatching. And that's something I can say for every book in my top 10, is that they all reward rereading. So because I'm not sure how Saga is going to fare in the future, it remains in my honorable mentions. One other thing about Saga is it's not yet complete. It could go completely off the rails, or it could destroy all the goodwill it's built up. And that's one of the things I have as a caveat in my top 10. Nothing in my top 10 is incomplete as far as my reading is concerned. So even if a series has completed, if I haven't finished the series, or if I haven't finished all there is to read, I find it difficult to put it in my top 10. What that means though is once I do finish some of these, they could very easily displace things that are in my top 10. And so the whole thing could change in the upcoming years. One of the books that has a chance of doing that is Planetes by Makoto Yukimura. This is probably the most realistic of the sci-fi books that I have over here. It's just slightly removed from where we are technologically and focuses for the most on human relationships and interactions, but in space. There are two volumes and I've only read the first one. It was excellent, and I have a very strong suspicion that when I finish it, it could be a real contender for the top 10. From something that is my own fault that I haven't finished to something that it's not, the next book on my honorable mentions is Rust by Royden Lepp. Rust falls into one of those sci-fi categories series that is post-technological, although there is technology like jetpacks. It's in a world that is now agrarian after a great war. The entire setup is beautiful. It's steeped in melancholy, which is accompanied in the art with this wonderful sepia tone that creates this nostalgia and makes the technology stand out in a very unique way. There are three volumes of Rust out. There was supposed to be a fourth, but it's never come out. From Archaea Press, I've been waiting for it for a while because I'm dying to know how the story finishes. It's one of the most accessible yet unique steampunkish stories that I've read, and it's a real pity that we don't have volume 4. Still, even as an incomplete story, this is definitely good enough to be amongst my all-time favorites. Next up is one of my favorite series from one of my favorite authors, Top 10 by Alan Moore, Gene Ha, and Xander Cannon. Top 10 is part of the America's Best Comics line that Alan Moore did, which included Tom Strong, Promethea, The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, all of which seem to be more famous and more well-known than Top 10, which is a real pity because as great as those other series are, this is an absolute gem. It's as much fun and as lighthearted as you're ever going to see Alan Moore be, which it shares to a certain extent with Tom Strong, but unlike Tom Strong, Top 10 also deals with some really serious issues and goes to some very dark places in its storyline. At the same time, it manages to be extremely tongue-in-cheek and funny and combines what seems like very opposite kinds of things perfectly. It's also a comic that perfectly marries superheroes with science fiction because superheroes is always one of those nebulous areas. Most superheroes would be science fiction because of radioactivity or artificial intelligence or something like that, but it might as well be magic in certain cases. So superheroes are a genre that could either be science fiction explicitly or could just hint at science fiction. All of the heroes over here are called science heroes. It's set in a city that is full of retired or erstwhile superheroes, and it's about a police precinct in that city. So superhero cops for a superhero population is the idea, and Alan Moore, Gene Ha, and Xander Cannon deliver in spades. A funny and serious book at the same time, full of Easter eggs and references, most of which are not a chore to try and dig through, and one of my favorite Alan Moore books. Next up is something quite different, The Thrilling Adventures of Lovelace and Babbage by Sidney Padua. Ada Lovelace, the daughter of Lord Byron, was perhaps the world's first computer programmer 100 years before a computer was created, and most of her theoretical work was based on the drawings and designs of a thinking machine invented by Charles Babbage, something that he never created. That's kind of the history of it, but this book reimagines them as partnering up, creating this machine and then using it to solve crime, among many other things. Their adventures are hilarious, but it's also one of the brainiest and scienciest books I've read. The footnotes in it take up half or more of the pages at times, and it's just a wonderful combination. The drawings and dialogue are extremely cheeky, but the science and mathematics are rigorous, and the entire ludicrous idea of them as a crime-fighting couple is approached with such joy that I feel really bad not putting this in my top 10 science fiction books of all time. As I do about not including Mind Management by Matt Kint. Mind Management is one of my favorite modern series and maybe one of my favorite series of all time. It's a twisting thriller that really twists and really thrills, and it never sits still with one great idea, cramming them all page after page, story after story, into this roller coaster ride about a secret organization full of people with special abilities. Although I classify it as science fiction, a lot of this could be looked upon as superheroics like X-Men, and while science will obviously play a role, as fantastic as this series is, I leave it out of my top 10 just because it's not sciencey enough, if that makes any sense. Which is not the case for Razzle by Jeff Smith. Razzle is a wonderful noir story about a dimension-hopping art thief, which uses the rivalry between Tesla and Edison as one of the foundational things in its science, and in spite of Jeff Smith being famous for Bourne, is a grown-up story. This is one of those books that gets more impressive on rereads, so there's a very good chance that it might sneak into the top 10 after my next read of it. Talking about rereading, another parameter that I used in making this list is I should have read anything on it at least twice. That means there are a number of things that I've read and really enjoyed that are disqualified for this list, because I think my top 10 sci-fi comics should be about more than just the gimmick or more than just about the plot reveal. It should be something that holds up with a little bit more than what just one read can sometimes give you, which is unfortunately why I have to leave out Finder by Carla Speed McNeil. Regular viewers of this channel will know know that I've only recently started reading Finder, and this is the Finder Library Volume 1. There is a Volume 2 out there and a Volume 3 to be published. So not only have I only read it once, but I also haven't finished it. So that's kind of a double disqualification. But everything I've read so far has been great. It's been unlike the other science fiction. It's closer to fantasy in certain ways, but it's also a post-technological world, somewhere where technology has been left behind because the grief it caused humanity, but remains interlinked to their lives. That's putting it a little too simply, and again, it's only based on the first volume, but I have a strong inkling that this is going to be a contender when I'm done with this series. And my final honorable mention for best sci-fi comics of all time is Zot by Scott McCloud. Zot, the hero of the title, is a superhero from another dimension, and half of this series takes place in that other dimension primarily, and the other half takes place in R, the normal dimension. Again, there's always going to be a little debate about where superheroes and science fiction intersect, but Zot is definitely a science fictional, although a retro, optimistic, Tomorrowland sort of science fictional superhero, and the kind of stories this series collects, although extremely human and deep, also deal with the kind of conundrums and situations that science fiction is so good at cooking up. As a vehicle for the human stories that Scott McCloud is interested in telling, Zot does a great job of managing superheroes as well as science fiction. The reason I leave it off the top 10, other than the fact that the top 10 has really good books too, is that so much of Zot purposely does away with the science fiction to deal with the more human aspects of stories. Especially the second half of the series, which I highly recommend to everyone, has very little science fiction in it or in the background. That doesn't mean it's not a fantastic series, just that the top 10's probably going to have science fiction on more pages. So that book makes it into the top 10. Hopefully I'll have that up very soon. In the meantime, feel free to leave your favorite science fiction comics in the comments below, or let me know if you'd like a closer and deeper look at any of these comics. This has been For the Love of Comics. Thank you as always for watching, and I'll see you at the next video.